Welcome to Science Goes to the Movies, a look at the stories of science and how they change our culture. I'm Lisa Beth Kovetz. Many longtime fans of Frank Herbert's Dune know the Bene Gesserit Litany Against Fear by heart. Repeat it to themselves in times of strife, and just in case they forget a line or two, tattoo portions of it on their bodies. In the 2021 remake of Dune, it's Paul's mother, Jessica, who first recites the Litany Against Fear as her son is tortured. To talk about other things you might do in a stressful situation, we're joined today by neuroscientist Wendy Suzuki, author of Good Anxiety. Wendy, thank you so much for stopping by to nerd out with us.
Oh, thank you so much. I'm a huge fan of the show.
Thank you. Oh, my goodness. Thank you. The first line of the litany is, I must not fear. Wendy, is it humanly possible or even a good idea to not fear? Are we just built that way?
It is not a good idea not to fear. Fear and anxiety evolved to protect us. It is actually essential for our survival. And you may wish that fear and anxiety may diminish in certain situations, but it's not possible, and in fact, it's dangerous not to have the capacity to feel the emotions of fear and or anxiety.
And what is the difference between fear and anxiety?
They are strongly intermeshed. It's in fact hard to separate them. Anxiety is typically the feeling of fear or worry associated with situations of uncertainty. Mm-hmm. So all of us can appreciate why societal anxiety levels have been so high in the last few years. Fear is typically that feeling that comes up when there's something immediate. Mm-hmm. But we all know that we can project our fear through our anxiety. So that's how they're linked.
Boy, can we.
Yes.
Yeah. The full title of Dr. Suzuki's book is Good Anxiety, Harnessing the Power of the Most Misunderstood Emotion. Why is anxiety the most misunderstood emotion?
I think it's misunderstood because people easily think, I just want to get rid of it. I don't want any more anxiety. There's shame around anxiety. That's another reason to kind of throw it out the door. But I'm here to say that anxiety is a normal, protective human emotion. Again, it evolved to protect us. And even though you might not be feeling particularly protected by your anxiety, what I try to do in the book is start with that basic premise that, you know, for 2.5 million years, this emotion has evolved to protect us from things that could be dangerous. And the reason why we're not feeling protective is because the volume of our individual and societal anxiety is just turned way too high. So step number one is let's use some science, let's use some neuroscience, let's use some psychology to learn how to turn the volume down on our anxiety to get it to that level where it is protective, where it's actually helpful, sometimes even beneficial to us, which comes to my title, Good Anxiety.
It makes you careful.
Yes,
it does. It makes you precise.
Yes.
It makes you mindful sometimes even.
Sometimes for me, it gives you energy. So that energy is like, oh my God, what's gonna happen? What if she asks me a question that I don't know? You know, I typically, I give so many talks, I use that fear and anxiety to propel my answers to these questions. I am harnessing right there. What am I harnessing? I'm harnessing my anxiety. I'm harnessing my fear. I'm harnessing that energy. That is how, one example, common example of how it could be good.
Throughout the Dune saga, the litany against fear is often spoken when someone is standing very still. As if controlling one's fears or anxieties can be managed through intellect or force of will. In real life, though, is managing anxiety a full body problem?
Absolutely. That I absolutely agree with. It's a mind-body problem. Let's start with the mind mindset. How can we approach anxiety in a different way? Can we have different beliefs around it? That's why I named the book Good Anxiety. Can you think that it's a possibility that your anxiety can bring you something good? And let's go to the body. How can you approach anxiety through your body? Well, one of the most transformative ways that you can shift your emotional state of mind is by moving your body. Physical activity is transformative for your mood. What it does is it releases all sorts of neurochemicals in your brain. I like to say it's like giving your brain a bubble bath of neurochemicals, including dopamine and serotonin and noradrenaline. And what does that do? It makes you feel rewarded. It makes you feel happy. It decreases those feelings of anxiety and depression. And that is very powerful for anybody that has that coming up on a regular basis.
Everybody's anxious about something. But at what point do we say this has gone beyond the capacity of self-help and we really need professional intervention?
Absolutely. So I like to tell people that when your anxiety becomes at a level that is debilitating, it does not allow you to live your normal life. Mm. It's one thing, I go to work and, oh, I have anxiety. That person always bothers me. Oh, that person, it's really giving me a lot of anxiety. But I'm still at work, I could still do it, it's annoying. But when it becomes debilitating, when you can't go to work, you can't get out the door to go to work, it affects your personal relationships, your work, your creative process. That is when you need medical help.
In its second line, the Bene Gesserit Litany Against Fear continues. Fear is the mind killer, is it? Are our brains different when we're fearful or anxious?
Absolutely, I agree with that part of the litany as well. Because this is kind of the why of why should we be concerned about our anxiety levels, our stress levels? The why is that we know from so many studies that long-term chronic stress and anxiety, or anxiety that causes that stress response in your body, will give you long-term higher levels of cortisol, the stress hormone. And you know what that does? That actually acts in your brain to first damage brain cells in two key brain areas, the prefrontal cortex, important for attention and decision-making, and the hippocampus, critical for long-term memory. First, it damages the dendrites of neurons in these areas, which are the input structures of the cells. And then with long-term stress, PTSD, for example, it will kill cells in these brain areas. Those cells don't come back. And a common finding in patients with PTSD is a smaller temporal lobe. What is actually happening is that there's many, many, many receptors for cortisol on hippocampal cells. And with too much flooding of cortisol, you end up basically exciting these cells to death.
Oh, good God.
Yeah, it's not good.
Now I'm worried about it.
Sorry. Well, change your mindset about that, because here's what you can do. Let me give you my two go-tos if you want to lower immediately your level of anxiety. Number one, we've already talked about, move your body. People say, oh, I don't have time to run a marathon. 10 minutes of walking has been shown to significantly decrease your negative mood states, including anxiety. Everybody can go take a walk for 10 minutes. That is an immediate effect. Again, that bubble bath of neurochemicals. Right. Number two, deep breathing, deep, slow breath, because you're activating what's called the parasympathetic nervous system, which is your natural de-stressing part of your nervous system. Think about monks. The oldest form of meditation is breath work, because even though monks hundreds of years ago didn't know the term parasympathetic nervous system, they knew that deep breathing could bring them into a calm, meditative state. And it happens immediately. It takes a little bit of practice just to try, but that is also a very powerful way to decrease your anxiety levels.
Can we change our brain's response to stimuli?
With practice, absolutely, you can. You can habituate. So if spiders give you anxiety, you can start thinking about spiders and associate them with, I don't know, ice cream, something good. And then slowly, this is one of the kind of approaches to habituate people to things that they're afraid of. But it's changing your belief system. If you think that spiders are terrible and going to kill you, they're always going to give you anxiety. If you start to appreciate their role in the ecosystem and what they contribute to the planet, that in fact, the vast majority of spiders are going to do nothing to you, you think, okay, maybe I can live with the spiders.
Wendy's book about anxiety is actually a really fun read, particularly for anyone interested in the brain. I found it very interesting reading your book that in the 1960s, it was an absolute held belief that the adult brain could not be changed.
Yes.
So what happened?
There was a neuroscientist that I had the honor of working with later in the 1980s, but in the 1960s, Marion Diamond and her colleagues at UC Berkeley said, you know, I don't believe that the adult human brain can't change. There's learning. I'm learning all the time. I'm an adult. can we show this? What is the evidence that we can show? And so she did classic experiments, raising rats in what she called an enriched environment, which is a rat cage full of toys that change all the time, lots of other rats to play with. I like to call it the Disney World of rat cages. And she compared the brains of those rats living in Disney World with rats living in what they called an impoverished environment with free food and water, but no toys and maybe just one other rat. What they showed is several months in living in these different environments completely changed the anatomy, physiology, and function of the brains of the rats living in Disney World. And that was the start of our understanding that yes, the adult brain is plastic. We have this capacity to change and grow.
And I don't think we can underestimate the enormity of that realization.
Absolutely. You know, it defines what we call wellness and self-help. Can we change the way we think? Can we evolve over time? That is the general topic of both my books, that I've explored it in myself after studying it for so many years in the lab.
Just about halfway through the Litany Against Fear, we get to the line, "Fear is the little death that brings total obliteration." And in her book, Dr. Suzuki, successful professor of neuroscience, is very open about her personal interactions with anxiety and stress and how they can chip away at a person. Wendy, how destructive is anxiety?
You know, it's very destructive. Everybody knows this instinctually. It makes you smaller. It makes you non-communicative. It cuts off flow, which is this wonderful psychological state that, you know, brings all the kind of creativity into you and allows you to perform at your highest level, which sometimes can make you even more anxious, like, oh no, I don't have flow. But it is cutting off creativity. On a neuroscientific level, it is deactivating your prefrontal cortex. So high levels of fear often are described as you just go into standard motor programs. You don't have the ability to think and decide and make higher level decisions. That's why you don't want to be in that state for a long time. You want to use it as a danger zone. So you want it in situations of, there's a fire, let's get out. Let's use that to use our fight or flight response. But in everyday situations where the news cycle or Instagram posts or existential crises about what's happening in the world today are just getting us down, we really want to be able to control that and get to a better state, because all of us need better creativity to be able to get through these very, very difficult times that we're living in.
I don't make good decisions when stressed because I can't really judge the information quite as well.
Yeah, and that is because stress is affecting your ability to use your prefrontal cortex, which is why knowing for you what are those tools to help modulate your mood state. The whole third part of the book is called How to Worry Well. And what I tried to do is just give as many different science-based and real-world examples as I can to show people that they have so many tools at their fingertips to try and modulate, to not focus so much on all of the bad things going on. But for example, just focusing on the present moment. What is going on right here? Yes, we're on TV. We're trying to say things in a good way, but everything is good, and we're still breathing. We're in a fun, excited state. Can you appreciate that?
Yes. I cannot tell you how many times my director tells me, slow down, it's fine.
Exactly.
In the dead center of the Bene Gesserit litany are the words, "I will face my fear," followed by, "I will allow it to pass over me and through me." But in her book, Professor Suzuki addresses the value of these negative feelings. First off, what does anxiety do to our energy level?
Yeah, so anxiety is a form of neural energy. And so one could take advantage of that energy, but in certain situations, especially if anxiety has been high for a long time, that starts to sap your energy. You feel like, you know, I always use this example of a big rock around your neck that you're dragging around, your rock of anxiety. So it is an energy sapper overall, but good anxiety can help you kind of harness that energy that comes with anxiety and use it to your advantage.
In part two of her book, Professor Suzuki offers ways to turn anxiety into a superpower. And here on Science Goes to the Movies, we are always interested in new ways to get superpowers. So am I going to have to dunk myself in gamma rays or toxic eels or what do you got?
No. So I talk about six different superpowers that come from anxiety. And let me just give you a few that are really easy to understand and really easy to implement. Like everybody listening today can implement it right now. So here's the easiest one. It is the superpower of productivity. So what if a superpower of anxiety is better productivity? How does that work? I'll tell you how it works. A very common form of anxiety is that what if list. What if I mess up when I'm, you know, doing my interview? What if I didn't send an email on time or in the right way or with the right wording? All of those what ifs, they hit me right before I'm trying to go to sleep. It's like, oh, I'm about to go to sleep. It's gonna feel so good. And then bing, what if I didn't do that? What if I did do that and I didn't do it the right way? All of these what ifs. Here's what I learned from a very smart lawyer. So this didn't come from me. This came from a lawyer that I was interviewing as I was writing the book. She said, I am the smart, well-paid lawyer that I am because of my anxiety. I've had anxiety all of my life, and I'm worried about everything the lawyers on the other side are going to say and do. And so what she does is she turns her what-if list into a to-do list. So everything you're worried about, you turn that into an actionable item. Importantly, not just a list, you do it. You check it off. You're worried about that email? Well, go and read it. Go ask somebody about it. Do something active about it, and then check that off your list. And that made her more productive and made her a better lawyer. And once I started to try and implement that, I was like, wow, all of my worries are turning into ways to get better prepared in so many different areas of my life. It is a superpower for everybody, not just special people, but everybody.
It must have made her and then you so very valuable to the people around you that you are working with, that you're interfacing with, if your anxiety keeps you on this very clear and clean track.
Yes, it absolutely is. I mean, I don't like to say, oh, can you turn that? You know, looks like you're anxious there. What, you know, what could you turn? It's a personal decision, and you have to play with it, practice with it. Like for me, what I really appreciated is that once I started to do that, it still woke me up a little bit at night. But then I said, you know, I'm going to address every one of those tomorrow morning. And because I always did it, I was like, I'm sure that I will do that. Now I couldn't go to sleep. It'll still wake you up a little bit. But because again, we can't get rid of our anxiety. It's there because there are concerns around, these are real concerns, but it does make you more productive.
The last line of the Litany Against Fear reads, and when it has gone, I will turn the inner eye to see its path. Where the fear has gone, there will be nothing. Only I will remain. And Herbert's words are poetic and beautiful and appropriate for the world of Dune, but Suzuki's writing offers a more practical, modern objective. So what is flow? How do we get it? Yeah. Why do we want it?
Yeah. So flow is a psychological construct that was identified by a psychologist with a very complicated last name, Csikszentmihalyi. It took me a long time to be able to pronounce that appropriately. And it's the idea that when you're doing something with high skill level, I always think of Yo-Yo Ma. So I'm a cello student. And I think of Yo-Yo Ma playing the unaccompanied cello suites. And not every time, but certain times, that time he was at Carnegie Hall, it was just flowing. It went beautifully. He got to different levels of interpretation that he'd never gotten before. And time slows down, and it's just such a beautiful experience. That is flow, and that's beautiful. But then you realize that anxiety can kill flow. If you have anxiety, you don't have access to flow. So now I'm depressed for two reasons. One, I don't have the skill of Yo-Yo Ma, so maybe I won't have flow in the first place. And two, I have anxiety, so now I've completely obliterated my ability to have flow. And I wanted to talk about this because flow is so important. It helps our creativity, it helps just our overall performance. And I realized that flow, actually my version of flow, micro flow, is a superpower, another one of those superpowers of anxiety. And how it works is this. We can all appreciate those tiny moments in the day where everything's going well. you're really enjoying it. I realized that at the end, I realized this, at the end of a yoga class, we go into corpse pose, shavasana. I was thinking about flow, that I was really into that chapter. I was laying there in shavasana and I thought, I'm flowing in shavasana. There's nobody laying on the ground better than I'm laying on the ground. I should own that. This is a moment of flow. I'm flowing in shavasana. And that just made me realize that there are so many other moments of the day. When you answer a question, you think, oh yeah, I gave a really good answer to that question. A little moment of flow. I make a green smoothie for myself every morning and I really enjoy it. So that's a moment of flow. The first cup of coffee, make it really well. Yes, yes, you can feel that one. Everybody can appreciate a moment of flow, but what makes it a superpower for those of us with everyday anxiety is because of the concept called the negative contrast effect, which means the highs in our life are higher because we have lows. And those lows come from the discomfort of anxiety. We all have anxiety during the day, but in fact, that discomfort makes my shavasana feel that much better. Oh. And those other moments of savoring that much better. So it becomes microflow, not classic flow, but microflow becomes a superpower for those of us that suffer from anxiety.
If you recognize it, if yeah. you own it, if yeah. you if you honor the flow and yeah. not just the low.
Yes, exactly. Oh, yeah. I love that. Can I use that? Can I use that? You flowed right there.
The first two parts of Good Anxiety address the neuroscience of anxiety, but then in part three of the book, Dr. Suzuki flips the focus to the reader's own emotional experience. So what is the art of worrying well?
The art of worrying well is basically an invitation to start doing some self-experiments on your own anxiety. What works for you? Maybe it's a Netflix comedy special, right? Maybe it is call your funniest friend, which I do very, very regularly when I need just a boost. These are practical things, and I tried to give so many different examples because everybody's different. You might not appreciate or use all of them, but I wrote it so that everybody would be able to find something in this toolbox to start to combat their own anxiety. And then I invite you to, there are surveys in there so you can kind of monitor your level of anxiety and test, do a A-B test. You know, what does Netflix special do versus what does going for a walk with my dog do? How are they similar? How are they different? Which one works better?
We love data.
Yeah, exactly, exactly. Self-data.
Yeah, self-data is very important, and yes. I think what sort of made me very excited about your book also is that it had all of these science things, and then it really brought it down to how can I use them
yes.
in my life. A lot of the things that you say really harken back to an earlier show we did a long time ago with Tony Bossis of NYU, who was doing an end-of-life psilocybin experiment
uh-huh.
for people with the anxiety of terminal cancer. Yeah. He did a, they tripped. They uh-huh. were tripping on mushrooms.
Uh-huh.
And they came to many of the same conclusions
uh-huh.
that you are, that,
uh-huh.
that you know, there is joy, and
yes.
I'm part of something. And
yeah.
it just occurs to me that what you're suggesting is actually quite a bit larger than just anxiety. It's who are we in life? How
exactly.
are we living in life?
Yeah, it's funny. You remind me that after I published this book, so many people from my past emailed me, oh, congratulations, including the Buddhist minister mm-hmm. from the high school Buddhist, you know, group that I was with. And he said, you know, Wendy, your book is very Buddhist. And I said, oh, really? I didn't. And I think you're getting at the same point. These are, you know, it started out as a science-based approach and a practical approach to anxiety, but it's really about an approach towards your life, an approach towards yourself, and appreciation of the self mm. and the importance of your own valuing yourself, valuing your brain, valuing your own body, that many of us don't spend enough time doing. So yeah,
sure.
I agree.
Absolutely. While many revere the Litany Against Fear, I take issue with the Bene Gesserit sisterhood as a whole, the creation of a circa 1960s man who invented some of the most powerful women in the galaxy, then relegated them to a world of whisperers, determined to reap political control by sliding into the beds of powerful men. as breeding concubines. So screw you, Frank Herbert. And maybe I just needed to get that off my chest. But are the ways that we, do men and women experience anxiety differently? And do they express it differently? And is that a cultural thing? Or are you seeing changes in the brain?
Yeah, I mean, the data are that there are more women that experience anxiety, that have clinical anxiety. And in fact, over the pandemic, one of the groups that had some of the highest increases in their levels of clinically reported anxiety were adolescent girls. Mm-hmm. And it was linked to social media use. So I don't think we know the answer to why that may be. I think it is very important in my own analysis of anxiety that I describe in the book, looking in on your own emotions, learning from what your anxiety, what your fear, what your anger really is telling you about your values, that absolutely may be different between the way that men and women approach it and the way different cultures approach it. There are some cultures that don't want to deal with those negative emotions at all. And I say it is very, very important. They're there for a reason. Mm-hmm. They're not there just to be repressed. They're there, again, for protection, to warn us about things. And that is part of the call of good anxiety. Can you start using those uncomfortable emotions? Note, I don't call them negative emotions or bad emotions. They are uncomfortable emotions, and they're there for a reason. Use them, and you will start to take advantage of your full humanness.
I think just those two words, negative and uncomfortable, are so hugely different, yeah. And yet when applied to the same situation can be really give you a very different end use for them.
Yes.
Wendy, but I am so sorry we are so out of time. It has been such a pleasure to talk to you. I hope you'll come back again with your next book.
Absolutely, would love to.